Ruffini. There is the Italian translation, but there is also the, I think, the original English version, where there are several things related to what I said, and it has it is useful to learn GR and with a different perspective, maybe, and with more. There are several things related to gravitational wave physics that are useful. So should I start? Yes. Okay. So yesterday we discussed the basis in a very, I hope, sufficiently pedagogical way. And today we start discussing the problem of generation of gravitational waves. In the sense, yesterday we were talking about gravitational waves in vacuum, in particular in the eventually plane waves, and we focused on the characteristic of the, let's say, the gauge invariant characteristic of a gravitational wave, so TT gauge. And just something that I want to remember, that yesterday I wrote the expression for the energy flux in the TT gauge, and R squared divided by G omega H dot TT IJ H dot TT IJ. So as I was saying, what I forgot to mention is that this R, in fact, is the distance from the source, so is the location of the observer. This is the solid angle, and this symbol means a average of several wavelengths. Now, I won't rewrite all the formulas that I wrote at the end of the lecture, but they will be maybe useful later. And the idea of today to start is to derive the quadrupole formula. And in order to really relate, if I have what is generating this HIJTT at the lowest order in the post-Newtonian expansion, so let's say using basically Newton theory for the dynamics, and then try to go a little bit beyond this step by step until, the idea is to do several explicit calculations so that you see things in how they develop in practice, and hopefully I will at the end of the lectures I will at least sketch the general multipolar expansion of gravitational waves, so the gravitational wave generation formalism, and give the results, the full results in linear theory. We won't go in the detail of all calculations, but the idea is just that you see things and you are used to what are the notation, what you have to expect, so that if you read anything, you will be able to catch the important information and the notation that somehow is can stop a bit. So start with, we are in the harmonic gauge and we are not in vacuum anymore. So we have this equation, C to the 4 T mu nu, and we are always in the condition that this is h mu nu minus 1/2 h mu nu h, this is h bar mu nu, and we are expanding around the Minkowski background, so that eta mu nu plus h mu nu with h mu nu in general smaller than one, so linearized gravity. Okay. So this is we have fixed the Lorentz gauge or the harmonic gauge, so H mu nu equals zero. Evidently, this also means that the stress energy tensors is conserved. We have this. I mean, this comes from Bianchi identity, so this is all what you... Okay, evidently this is a wave equation, so the wave equation can be solved using the Green function, so, and the solution of this equation is simply minus 6 pi g, formally, let's say, c to the 4 x prime t mu nu x prime, where the Green function is, as usual, defined by, say, okay, I have the D'Alembertian of g x minus x prime equal delta 4 x minus. Okay? Now, you have waves that are propagating away from the source, so you will choose the retarded Green function, that is this. There is a minus. Pi. This is a three-dimensional x minus x prime, and here you have the delta function t minus x prime over c minus t prime. Okay. Well, evidently. This is the Green function. I forgot to mention something, so let's say that we have a source here. You are here, so this is x. You have a point inside the source, and this vector is x minus x prime. Okay? So this is the Green function. You plug it into H mu nu. You have to do the integration so that. So that eventually this becomes let me do all the calculation explicitly so that you see exactly what you have to do. So the red x, then 1 over x minus x prime, you have this, the delta inside t minus x prime c minus t prime, t mu nu t prime x prime. You do the integration, and eventually you have this x 1 divided x minus x prime t mu nu, that is a function of the retarded time, and of the source. Okay, so this can go away. So the solution is H mu nu. Okay, so it's given by an integral on the three-dimensional stress energy tensor distribution of the source. Okay, so far so good. I didn't do anything special. Now, first, this is H mu nu and H bar mu nu, and what we saw yesterday is that we want to extract from this the physical components. So wherever you will have to apply to this the projection operator, and you will select just the spatial components, the three components of the thing. So that we recall that we had the, okay, can I erase? I think so, right? At least I will just keep the H bar mu nu. So, as I said yesterday, from the Lorentz gauge, you go in the transverse traceless, you select the transverse traceless component using the projector operator, which means it is pi ej kl, that I was defining yesterday, with p ek pjl minus 1 half PEJ PKL. Okay, but evidently this is, okay, we are, let's say that the structure is the following. So you are here, this is the source, then you are, this is the direction of propagation, and then this is defined as the object that will take your wave that is propagating, I mean your tensor that is propagating here, and will project it on the plane orthogonal to the direction of propagation and remove the trace. So that this PEJ is in fact given by this, sorry, I'm getting writing again too small. So what I was saying yesterday, PIJ is delta IJ minus NE and J, where evidently NE, okay, this is X, Y, and Z, and then is the direction of propagation. And eventually, the solution, once that you project this, all the 0, 0, 0, 0 I components go away, and you just have this, that akij tt is equal to, yeah, I was reintroducing here all the physical units, c to the 4 pi ej kl integral over the x prime 1 over x minus x prime, and then you take only the spatial components of the stress energy tensor as a function of the retarded time and x prime. Okay? Spent a lot of time saying trivialities. Anyway, just to be sure that I don't lose pieces. Okay. Now, the multiple expansions, the multiple expansion come in the sense that you want to solve, to do this integral, and the way of doing this integral is basically expanding this object, assuming that the fact that you are very far away, so you can do an expansion. Actually, what you will do, there are two expansions. First of all, you expand this piece, assuming that you are very far away from the source, which is obvious, you can do that. And in this expansion, I mean, far away means what? Means that the farther you are, the more you are myopic to the small details of the source, to the fact that the source is not, I mean, is something that may be, okay, it can be a binary black hole, okay, it can be anything else, and if you are very far away, okay, it is just a point, you don't see anything, great, but you want to take into account the structure, so you will have to do an expansion in, so if you are very far away, nothing, you start adding terms, it means that you are, you start becoming sensitive to the to the local structure of the system, and this is the multipolar expansion eventually. So this is what you do, and this is comes from this piece, and then you do also a slow velocity expansion that allows you to expand the stress energy tensor. And when you put the two things together at the lowest order possible, you get the Einstein quadrupole formula. So the lowest order formula for the generation of gravitational waves that was derived by Einstein in 1916. Modulus factor 2 that was actually corrected by Eddington later. But this is a detail. Then, this is the lowest order, but there are all the other pieces that come out from here. And also you can, in a sense, relax the slow velocity hypothesis, in the sense that you can add higher order terms in the velocity, and this is the post-Newtonian expansion eventually. So you have a mixture of all the pieces. Okay, so first of all, let's do this better. So let's make a nice plot. so redo better what I was doing before. So as I said, you are here, so this is X, your coordinate system is centered here, this is X prime, and this is X minus X prime. Okay, then we define that R is the modulus of X and N is the versus, which means X divided by this. Okay, then this is the angle theta, and this is what we call, so the versor is this, and this piece is N times X. Okay, now as I said, we are very far away, so we can, the idea is to expand this piece. So first of all, let's recall this formula that X minus X prime is in fact given by what? The modulus X square plus X prime square minus 2 X prime X cos theta, where theta is this angle here. Okay. Then, as I said, you define R in this form and you rewrite this equation as just R square 1 minus 2 times, sorry, this is N times X prime divided by R, which means this small piece here, plus X prime square over R square. Okay? You take the square root, sorry, this is in fact the square, then you take the square root, X minus X prime, which is just R square root of 1 minus 2 N X prime divided by R plus X prime square divided by R square. You plug this piece here, and then you expand by assuming that R is much larger than X prime. That is, you expand this thing in using this as a small parameter, which means eventually that your X minus X prime is approximately equal to R minus N times X prime modulo order 1 over R, which means R 1 minus N X prime divided by R plus order 1 over R square. Okay? Correct. When you plug it in there, you remove everything, and what you get is just that, you take only, because you do two things. You have one expansion, you put this here, and you put this here. And you here you keep the thing at the lowest order, so you in N plus X, and you have a term that depends on N plus X here, and N times X here, and you neglect the higher order pieces. So eventually, I think that I can write it here. What you get is that you have the hij in the tt gauge is just the 1 over r 4g divided by c square your projector ij kl in the radial direction. Then you have the integral of d3x tkl. Yes, correct. And then you have t minus r over c plus n times x prime divided by c over x prime. So you got rid of one piece, so the 1 over x minus x prime at the lowest order is just 1 over r, that is here, but you have still to deal with this thing. Okay, at this stage, what you say is, I do a low velocity expansion, so I assume that the system is quasi Newtonian, but in fact doing a lower velocity expansion means again expanding in this parameter here, and the reason is the following. So let's say that, okay, let's see if I remember what was the reasoning. Yes, probably I do. The point is the following. So let's say that d is the typical dimension of the source, and in fact this d means okay, then why is it that I don't remember things? I'm lost here. Let's forget about this. You are very far away, and it is formally like having an expansion in this parameter. And when you expand in this parameter, you have that your your x minus x prime that you have here is approximately given by r 1 plus n time x prime. I will go back to the calculation later and try to remind to myself what was the point. The point is that doing a low velocity expansion is like expanding in this small parameter, because this is a characteristic size of the system, and the characteristic size of the system is proportional eventually to it's given to the I mean, you have a velocity, and the velocity is proportional to a certain frequency of the system and a certain characteristic length of the system. So that if you saying that this thing is very small, is like saying that the size of the system is very small with respect to the rest. So that you can indeed expand in this parameter. And I mean, what you can do formally, and in fact you replace. You expand this piece using this as a small quantity, and doing this as a small quantity means that you do just a Taylor expansion of this piece, which means that this becomes 1 over r 4g over c4 plus ij chi l n, and then you have this, and then you have okay t chi l computed at t minus r over c, simply this piece disappears x prime, then you have the first derivative, which means the time the zero with respect to time tkl t minus r over c x prime, and you have x prime e and e over c plus 1/2. Yes, what is important to remember is that since you have a c here, there is really, I mean, here you have the zero, but here you have 1 over c. And then you have 1 over c square, t to 0, tkl, t minus r over c, x prime, and then xj, ne, nj. This is just the standard Taylor expansion in this parameter, while evidently xe and e means n times x small. Okay? So far so good. More or less, I adjusted the thing approximately. Now what you see here? What you see here is that wherever you have this appear this combination xi and I, with the three-dimensional, the three components of the stress-energy tensor. I mean, the point is that this, I mean, you actually can see this this expansion better in the frequency domain, because when you go in the frequency domain, you find that there is a frequency characteristic, and what you are actually doing is an expansion on low frequencies. Low frequencies is equivalent to expanding into this parameter. Okay. Now, at this stage, this is. Okay, this is good. What can I do later? Because something that is useful now is to use the conservation of stress energy tensors, so the mu t mu nu equals zero, to make here appear the T00 component of the stress energy tensor. And then in the Newtonian limit, this will just be the mass density, okay? In fact, because you see, quadrupole formula means what? The quadrupole means rho xi, xj, actually the STF quadrupole, the symmetric trace free, this. And rho is T00, okay? This is what we are usually taught at school. So the next step is to replace these pieces. So what we need now is using the conservation of the stress energy tensor to do this replacement. So there is one has to use the fundamental identity, which is there are several things. So let's say okay. Yes, because here we have a second order time derivative, and okay. Okay. So D0 TK, dov'è che l'ho messa? Okay. Ah, yes, of course. Sorry. I forgot what I was looking at the second order piece, but in fact, I have to look at here. So, what we have to use is the following thing that this, yes. What you can demonstrate is the following that this piece, T00 xk, there is the following identity, xk d3x. Is equal to the integral T3 x prime, okay, of TKL. Okay? So if we start by neglecting all these pieces that I wrote there, because these are higher order post-Newtonian corrections. Wherever it is, let's say this is like if this was v, typical velocity of the system, or omega or whatever. So it's a small parameter in which you do the expansion. So this is the Newtonian thing. This is the first order, this is the second order, and so on and so forth. So what happens is that there exists this identity that then I will briefly rederive, see whether I'm able to do that. And then you define what is the quadrupole, or let's say the second moment of the source, which is really this piece. I mean, you define this as, sorry, you define mij, white thing, which is the integral of d3x of t00 xi xj. Okay? So, the steps are the following. Let's forget about this for the moment. We will rewrite it later. So this becomes 1 over r 4g divided by c to the 4 pi e j k l and the integral of, let's say, yes, I said d square over d tai square of this thing, x k xl d3x, which means indeed 2g over c4 pi ej kl 2 time derivatives of this computer at the retarded time. Okay, so this is the quadruple formula. So the lowest order solution. So in practice, how do I compute a gravitational wave? I have a stress energy tensor of something that depends on time and space, and you compute this tensor, you take time derivatives, and that's it. Okay, there are several things. So this is basically what one finds in the usual books, in the sense that you look at any book, in the first approximation they tell you this is the quadruple formula, you use this is a tensor, and you get the tensor, the metric tensor, so the waveform as a metric tensor, and then from this you will have to derive the H plus and H cross. So I will do that later, but from now already I want to tell you that in fact in practice, when you do real research, you and you deal with gravitational waves, is you don't usually work with IJ indexes, but instead you work in expansion in spherical spin weighted spherical harmonics, so that instead of use of having this typically in any literature, you will find these HLMs that are basically the spherical components of these tensors. So in expansion of these tensors in tensor spherical harmonics, that is what is used normally. So what I want, but there are still a few things. Okay, there is the identity, I don't think, but this can be obtained easily just from taking t mu nu equals zero, and then doing a bit of algebra. What is important is now to look carefully at this expression, because what I said is that I'm canceling it, but MKL is the integral on d3x t00x kxl. So this is a tensor that is symmetric, and it has a trace also. This projection eliminates the trace, because you go in the TT gauge, and in fact transverse and traceless gauge. This means that the fact that this object has a trace has no meaning. So for at the level of gravitational wave generation emission, so in fact the only components of these tensors that are relevant are the only tensor here that is relevant for this calculation is the tensor that is trace free, because this thing by itself eliminates the trace, so it's like if the trace here was not there. So you don't look convinced, don't worry. Okay, so this is just to say that in fact what is relevant at the real, because this is the second moment, but the quadruple in fact is what you take here and you remove the trace. So you take what you define is the quadruple tensor, which is Mij minus 1/3 delta Ej M KK, where this is the trace. Okay, so in fact the correct formula is the one where you put here this Q, or in other words you are taking the trace-free part of the original moment. And Actually, this will happen at any multipolar order, in the sense that if you go up with the multipolar expansion, you will always have the same thing, in the sense that what is important for the gravitational wave expansion is to use a symmetric, of course, and trace-free tensors, so that the expansion in multiples that we are doing here is equivalent to an expansion in symmetric trace-free tensors. And the reason why is so because basically what you are doing, you are expanding the tensor, the tensors that will appear in the subsequent multipolar expansion into irreducible representation of SCO3, which are exactly symmetric, given by symmetric trace-free tensors. So you need a basis, and this basis is a complete basis of tensor, and this is given by the by STF tensors, and you expand this on that. But this we'll try to see it step by step, hopefully, let's say. Okay, now this is done. Maybe not exceptionally, but it is done. And but before doing that, let's do the more pedantic calculation. In a sense that what happens is the following. Let's say you have this, and then from this you want to compute explicitly the gravitational waves. And what happens is, okay, maybe this is just something that you can find looking at the book of Maggiore, but what you can do is that, okay, I have HIJ, and then I want to get the H plus and H cross components. And to do that explicitly, because what you have HIJ, and HIJ TT is given by what? By you have H plus times EIJ cross plus H cross EIJ, sorry, plus and cross. So what you want is to single out these components. Single out these components means, in fact, doing this calculation explicitly, because this is a tensor that actually I can write explicitly for your pleasure, that is written here. So that in fact the projection tensor is IJKL. When you write everything explicitly, you get the following: DIK delta JL minus 1 half delta IJ delta KL minus NJ NL delta IK minus NI NK delta JL plus 1 half NK NL delta EJ. If one wants to do the calculation explicitly, you need to know what you have there. NJ delta KL plus 1 half N E NJ NK NL. But this is just to understand what is really in that formula, okay? Even if it is boring, it is pedantic, but in this way you see all the pieces, okay? Where, okay, delta is the usual three tensor, and E is the versor, so that it is how is it? So you have nz, which is cos theta, nx is cos theta. Maybe cos theta cos phi, and ny is cos theta sin phi. So in fact you are here, no? You have x, y, z, this is theta, go down, this is phi, okay? The usual thing. And so if I want exactly the component of the JJ tensor, of the TT tensor at some point here on the surface, so let's say my source is here, this thing is propagating, you get a distance r, and here, imagine that you have your detector there, you want to see how does the TT component look like. Very good, you have this that depends on the angles. You have it here. You contract this thing with the quadruple, an explicit formula for the derivative of the quadruple moment that is computing doing this integral. And finally, you will have the TT gauge, the components of the metric in the TT gauge. In the simplest possible situation that I think, imagine that, so that all the angles disappear, imagine that you are here along the z-axis. I think if this is, yes, I think this is correct, in fact, along the z-axis, because I put everything to zero, because along if you are just moving along the z-axis, this is very, very simple. Ah, yes, what I forgot, because, yes, this is the explicit expression of the tensor, but it might be more useful to see this as a... I mean, when you have to apply this to a tensor, in fact, it is better to see... because this was... coming from using the project from a combination of the simple projector operators. And in fact, when you apply this to a tensor, in fact, when you do PEJKL to a tensor AKL, okay, one thing is to do the calculation index by index. But in fact, you can write this as a matricial product time P, probably there is a transverse, transpose here. P A P times 1/2, sorry, minus 1/2 P trace P times A. I think it is this way, where the P was the tensor that I was defining yesterday. That I mean the usual projector tensor that I never remember by heart, but it is the usual thing. So it's what, yes, delta j, yes, of course, delta j minus any anj. So in this way you can do this calculation just as a matricial product. And if you are along the z-axis, this means is just thing zero. You are projecting the thing on this plane. And if this is the case, what you get at the end so, supposing that you are here and you want to see the waveform here, you will have that H plus is like this, is just 1 over R G over C to the 4 M dot dot 1 1 minus M dot dot 2 2, and H cross is equal 2 over R G over C to the 4 M dot dot 1 2. Okay? Just to go from the beginning to the end, doing all the, let's say, boring boring things. Actually, I mean, I'm mentioning this, for example, because for years, I mean, when I started doing this job, it was impossible, actually, looking at the literature to understand where all these formulas were coming from. In the sense that you were looking at some paper, they were using a multipolar expansion. Some others were using IJ. In some other papers, I say, okay, the formula is this. We just put ourselves, we look at the waveform along the z-axis where it is stronger, and then we have this expression. And there was no way of matching the things together and understanding where things were coming from. So for years, I mean, I was looking at this, okay, very good, but in general, what is the point? The point is this. I mean, it's just that things were a bit, at least for me at the time, a bit, I was young, a bit hidden right and left. Okay, but in practice, okay, this is along the z-axis. In practice, this is a general dependence on the angles. Now, is this really what one uses? As I was mentioning, indeed, no. In the sense that what the usual formula that you will find everywhere in the literature now is the following. Is a formula that it tells you that H plus minus I H cross is given by a sum over LMs, sorry, L from 2 to infinity, sum over M that minus L to L of HLMs times these objects. Okay? Where these objects are the spin-weighted spherical harmonics, or spin weight minus 2, which is basically the generalization of the usual spherical harmonics when you have to expand a field of spin 2, which is the case. I mean, you are in if you have a scalar field, you just expand the scalar field is in YLM, standard spherical harmonics. If you have a vector field, you will have vector spherical harmonics. If you have a tensor field, in this case, I mean, a field with two indexes, you will have a spin two spherical harmonics. In general, you can have this for any spin. The subtlety now, and now we will see things when we go to the higher order thing, is that if here there is just one kind of spherical harmonics, as soon as you move from vector to tensors and so on, you move away from the scalar case, you will have two kinds of spherical harmonics, the one that are even, that are the electric ones, and the one that are odds for parity transformation, that are the magnetic ones. So the ones that are associated to the mass multiples and the others that are associated to current multiples. So that in fact, wherever you work, you always work using this HLM thing. Now, the HLM thing means, let's see if I can do this now already, because I, just to give you a flavor of the thing. You have a tensor here, and you want basically to expand these tensors in spherical harmonics. And there are useful things in the sense that what you realize is that there is the following thing, that if you have your usual nx, sorry, for the usual vector the n direction, you can, and if you have the usual YLM, there is the following formula. I mean, you can define some objects that are called YLM, let's say I1, I2, IL, with n indexes that you can contract with n, let's say n I1, n I2, n IL things. And these are what are called are tensor spherical harmonics, which are a basis of the symmetric trace free tensors that you see at the lowest order piece. So basically what you can do is just to take this HIJ, contract it this piece, contract it with the corresponding YLM, and in fact you don't even need to know the expression of this thing, because what it happens is that you always have n components of n that remain, because you see you have this formula, but this formula means that you have actually your r square, because okay, you have xk and x l, okay, but if we define the modulus of the vector is r, so it means that xk is in fact r times nk. Hmm? So whenever in these formulas you always have an r square, nk, and an l. And what you do in practice, you always have the you always take the spherical components of these tensors, which means taking this piece, multiplying it by this, I mean, projecting this on this basis, this thing will disappear in the sense that the spherical harmonics will appear because of this formula. And you will forget about these indexes, and you will just work with multiples in this way. Is it clear? No. Okay, it was just an anticipation of the thing, and to get you used to what will come next. So exactly what is not clear? Everything. Sorry? Here you will have the at first order, the quadrupole formula will just be the 2-2. So in fact, in this case, what we'll do, you will just have, I mean, actually, you have a sum over LM that I forgot to mention, because in fact, I think here, yes. What happens is that you can turn this formula around, and in fact, you have a general tensor, which is A1 AL with L indexes, is just given by the sum between minus L and L of some TLM times the I1 IL things. Okay? So you are taking a tensor and you are expanding it into its spherical components. These objects are orthogonal so that you can eventually replace all the tensor formulas with LMs. Which one? Here? No. We have. It is just that this formula is computed along the z-axis. So I remove the angular dependence by construction. But in general, here you have dependence on the angles. You have always pieces that depend on the angles here. I will come back on this later. Now you saw the thing and you can start thinking about that. Now, but it is to say that this is not what is used in practice. I mean, it is used for doing calculation because it is post-Newtonian calculation, but it's not used in practical terms. Okay, so. Yes, then what I wanted to do, then I wanted to do the following. Let's say that we have this formula. So the Hij in the TT gauge with our thing. And then let's play a little bit with this. Okay. Now I have not specified anything about what is this? When did I start? 11:30? Okay, so we can stop 5 minutes. Good. So, before continuing, since I was reminded what I was supposed to know, let's go back to the expansion that blocked me before. And practically, you are expanding this small distance parameter. Actually, in doing that, it's like doing a low velocity expansion because of all the following reason. I mean, to understand that, you have to go in the Fourier domain. Because, in fact, if you do the Fourier transform, let's say we start from this. And we said this times N divided by C X prime, okay? And what I said, just to keep the lecture going, I said, okay, we take this, it is small, and we expand in this. But what is the meaning of this? When you go in the frequency domain, you find that this is, you do the Fourier transform, 2π/4, you have the Fourier transform of the stress energy tensor, which is omega k, And then you have epsilon minus I omega t minus r over c plus x times n over c plus, okay, this plus I k x, okay? Now, this is the frequency here on which you integrate, because it's a deforeic. But in fact, what happens is that you have a source, and this source has a characteristic frequency, okay? And in fact, this omega, this is a distance, this is a small distance, so this means that this is a velocity, omega times this, and this is divided by c. So what you are saying is that here, omega times x n is some characteristic velocity of the source, and what you say, okay, this is divided by c, and if I say that the source is slowly moving, I can actually expand in this parameter. And that's what you have behind. So in practice, you see, it's like expanding in a small distance in that case, so that you can do everything blindly, saying from the very beginning, there is something that is very small, and I can expand from the beginning to the end. So in one piece, either outside the source, so the 1 minus x prime, and within the stress energy tensor. But in fact, the origin of the two expansions is different. In one case, it's just that you are far away, so you are myopic to the small details. Okay, maybe it's in a sense similar thing. On the other piece, you are saying that I have a velocity, and this velocity is smaller than the speed of light. Okay? Just to correct what, to say better what I said before. Yes? Okay, maybe I can keep this 1 second. But I haven't invented anything. I mean, all this reasoning is done in great detail on the book of Michele Maggiore. Elsewhere, in other derivation of the quadrupole formula, you just forget about this this subtlety. But you just expand far away, and everything is fine. Okay. So let us forget for the moment about the spherical components of the tensor. This will come back later, because these are useful, especially for those that are among you and that I know that will dedicate their research life to gravitational wave astronomy or whatever. You are still in time to change advice. But before that, so, okay, the idea is, what I was saying, let's play with this. So why I'm doing this? This is useless. So we just use quadrupole radiation, and let's see what we learn in, apply the general formula in this case. It could be useful without saying anything about the source. So, for example, you can compute the energy. So you can compute, the energy flux. So E dot, which is C3 over R squared divided by 32 pi G integral d omega of this H dot IJ TT times H dot TT IJ. Ah, yes. Now this is important. Where was, yes, you yesterday were asking something. Yes, it was you who came in my office. What? One of the two, both of you, actually. Yes, but it was him, not you, the other guy. Doesn't matter. Is that was the direction. Okay, now you see that this is 1 over r. So from this formula, you will finally see how the power is coming out, I think. That, in fact, it will just depend. All this r square will disappear. So the fact that you have an r square here will disappear when you plug this here. So you cannot see anything from here. You will have to do explicitly the calculation. So, okay, so the point was, I have this formula, I want to plug this in and do the explicit calculation to see what happens at the end, because it is one of the useful formulas. So if you do this, you just get that you have g over 8 pi c to the 5. Then there is, you take another derivative, so you have that the quadruple is just third derivative of the so QK, yes, EIJ, QKL, QKL, you have to take the trace of this object, T minus R over C, and then you remain with this fantastic integral over the solid angle of the KL. Ah, no, yes, wait a second. Yes, because, sorry. Sorry, I forgot, because in fact, if you do the thing, you have different index here, KL, and this is contracted with a single object, because what happens, that this object is a projector, so that the square of this is the same thing. So, in fact, you can verify that if you have PEJKL times PIJ OP, you get again pi KL OP. So that when you take this, you put it here, you put it here, the index are saturated, you get again this object. And then you are left with the need of doing this integration. And but this is not too complicated, but it is good to know it. You can verify things. So for example, you can verify that if you do the omega over 4 pi and I and j is 1/3 delta ej, and then if you do this, the omega over 4 pi and e and j and k and l is something with delta functions, so delta ij delta kl plus delta ek delta jl plus delta el delta jk, and you can obtain these identities just with doing integration of sinus and cosinus. Okay, this looks boring, but one has to see where all these pieces come from, so that eventually you can demonstrate that this integral is just JKL is just 2 pi over 15 11 delta EK delta JL minus 4 delta EJ delta KL plus delta IL delta JK. Okay? So you plug everything together, and eventually you find that the energy flux is equal to G over 5 phi C to the fifth, the average of Q three derivatives of IJ Q IJ. Okay? So this is the formula. You can forget about all the rest before, and for the rest of your life you can remember this. Or and in fact, what is this? So this is in fact the fact that, I mean, the energy flux is the square of the time derivative of the metric, and the when you write this using spherical components, this will just reduce to the sum over Lm to the, let's say, QLm square dot, three derivative QLm square. but this maybe we'll redo later explicitly for the case of a particle on circular orbit. So this is one thing. Then you can, evidently, you want to apply the same thing to the angular momentum, to the computation of the angular momentum, that I want to do in detail, of course. So can I maybe erase here? And you have the flux of the angular momentum, which is evidently a vector, is given, repeating exactly the same calculation, but with the other formula for the angular momentum flux, you get 2g over 5 to the 5 epsilon IKL, where epsilon is the usual totally antisymmetric tensor in three dimension. And this is Q dot KA, Q three dots LA. Okay? So these are the formulas with the quadrupole moment. And in fact, you see that this is, let's say, this is H, this, times H dot. And I said, and this is H dot times H dot. Actually, the structure is there for all multiples. It's not just there for the 2-2. In the sense that for any waveform, I mean, if you take a waveform expanded in multiples, multipolar expansion, for each LM, you will see that the energy is H dot square, the energy flux, and the angular momentum is H times H dot. So far, so good. Now, what is, I think, more interesting, and we do it maybe explicitly, is the computation of the linear momentum at the lowest order quadrupole formula. And maybe I can do it here. Can do it here. So the linear momentum, the flux of linear momentum is, the formula was C3 R square divided by 32 pi G integral of the omega H dot ij dt dk h ij dt. Okay, so this is the general formula. Yes, so just to be clear, this is the general formula, which means that also whatever order of the multipolar expansion I'm using. So because I stopped at the lowest order, but I could have kept going, keeping at higher order terms. It's always the same formula is valid. Okay. Okay. When you do this and you do the usual replacement, yes, here I have to recheck the calculation, but I think. Okay, I will recheck the calculation later. Anyway, the important thing, because I don't want to lose time and to because there was a parity thing that I have to recheck. But the important thing is that when you do the calculation explicitly, you find that the linear momentum emitted, the flux of linear momentum emitted at lowest order using just the quadrupole formula is zero. But this is just because you are stopping at the lowest order and there are terms that are cancelling. In fact, the linear momentum, gravitational wave emit, take away linear momentum, but the linear momentum, as I was saying, is given, the linear momentum flux is given by the interference between various multiples. So that if you just use the QIJ here, you have nothing. But if you took pieces with higher with more indexes, which means I stop, for example, I take the what we will discuss in 1 second, what it means, the current the current quadrupole or the mass octuple, they mix together because each piece comes, there are more pieces that come in each piece in each one of these two things, and you will have effectively an emission of linear momentum. Yes, yeah, I think okay. This was just a reminder, but it is useful to recall here, and you can do the thing explicitly. Now, let's go a bit further. Which is going back to the expansion of the multipolar expansion in the form we were using it before. So I can erase everything I imagine, right? So let me rewrite this thing. Hij tt is equal 1 over r, 4g divided by c to the 4, pi ej kl, integral d3x, and then we said, okay, d3x prime, and then we said here, tkl t minus r over c x prime. So now we know everything of this, so this gives us the quadrupole formula, standard. Then there are the other pieces. So there is 1 over c, the, I don't know, d0, maybe, tkl t minus r over c x prime, and here we have our infamous thing, x, sorry, this is, let's call it x prime e and e, and then there is the 1/2 1 over 2 c square t to 0 t kl t minus r over c x prime e, x prime j, and e and j, okay? And so on and so forth. So, there is an infinite number of terms. Let us now focus on this. This is the first correction to the Newtonian case, let's say. And what do we do? We do the same thing that we were doing before, in the sense that we make appear, if here I wanted to make appear explicitly the moments of t0, 0, okay? Here we can play with this thing in order to make appear explicitly the moments of t0, 0, so the energy density and the currents, the energy currents. So that in fact, I mean, you will have here mass density, you will have mass currents. And then, starting from this and elaborating this piece, you will make appear the angular momentum of the waves carried away by, I mean, the angular momentum, actually not, sorry, the angular momentum of the source here. And you will see that there are some pieces in the gravitational wave that are generated by angular momentum, the fact that the source has a certain angular momentum. But these pieces do not enter at the lowest order, but enter at the first post-Newtonian order. Okay. So let's say this is this will be eventually the 1PN correction. And actually, all this can be, as I was saying, can be done in a very systematic way. But I want to do these things a bit step by step, if I can. So, for example, we can rewrite this following the notation that is there with... okay, I can define the following tensor S I J K, which is just 3x of t. Maybe this is not even needed. Anyway, you define the following. So yes, you define the following quantities. So, as I said, you have, this is the, yes, this is the monopole that actually, no, it won't appear in any place, but let's say in general, you have this. So, as I said before, we define the two-moment tensor, the two-moment of the mass density, which is 1 over c squared, d3x t00 x I x j. We can define, because of this thing, also an object with three indexes, e j k, which is the three moment, 1 over c square integral d3x t00 x e x j x k. And similarly, you can define the moments of the mass current, which means, for example, pi, which is which means 1 over c d3x t0e, pij equal 1 over c d3x t0e with a second index and can be this, and then pejk equal 1 over c integral d3x t0e xj xk. All these are things that are there, are well defined, and these are the moments of the mass and current density. And the point is that you can rewrite this piece using all these things. And in fact, if you do this explicitly and you you use the identities that I was saying before, actually you can derive other things, I think, for doing that. You eventually, you are, okay, here we can call this, this is in fact a, yes, a time derivative, yes. Yes, because let's say that, okay, actually, this is xe, okay? So x prime e. So what I do is I actually define a tensor that is called, I can define, okay, this I wrote already. I can define this tensor as ij comma k, which means that you have the integral of d3x tij xk, okay? And then what appears there is the time derivative of this tensor, okay? Because you have the delta t of this, and on the x does not count. And what happens is that you can rewrite this object in the using all these pieces. So you can rewrite this in the following form as 1 over 6 m dot dot I j k, which means that you have the third time derivative of the mass octuple, or let's say the third moment of the energy density, plus one third of, oh yeah, of the other quantity that are, that will be related to the angular momentum eventually. Sorry, this is just two derivatives here. Two derivatives j ik minus 2 p dot dot k ij. Okay. Now, as usual, there is the projector here that eliminates the traces. So, what you want for this, for this tensor will have to be symmetric, of course it is symmetric, and trace-free, because the traces are not needed, eventually. So, what you do is to, from this, for example, let's focus first on this piece, you can remove the trace, because it doesn't count. Now, what is the trace? The trace of, okay, this I can remove. So I can define a new tensor that I call, that will be the octupole, the mass octupole, KLM, which is MKLM, minus the trace. The trace means that you take each one of these, each couple of these indexes, you contract them among themselves, and you subtract what from this tensor. So, yeah, I know this looks a bit boring and technical, but I think it's necessary to understand what is going on. So, for example, this, you have a tensor where you have saturated two indexes, plus d delta km m k prime l k prime plus delta lm m k k prime k prime, okay, which means that for each index I am contracting here, and then I'm subtracting, this is one trace, this is the second trace, this is the third trace, I'm subtracting everything. You can do this for a tensor of any indexes, okay. If you have n indexes, you can define, if you have an index m with a1, let's say al indexes, you can define its symmetric trace-free version that I can indicate with a net, which is given by m a1 al minus 1 over l factorial, which is in fact, here it is at three indexes, in fact this is 3 plus times 2 times 1, and then you take the delta E1 EL, I mean L copies of the delta, and times, and then each time you take the tensor and the, I don't know, the L minus 1 and the L indexes are identified, okay? So this is to define a general symmetric trace-free tensor. So you have this piece, and this means that, in fact, the contribution given by this part can just be written, for example, to the waveform, will just be written. So let's say TT, the octupole, which is in fact the L equal 3 contribution, if you think to the expansion in spherical harmonics, is 1 over R 2G over 3 C square pi EJ KL NM, because there is still an N that is remaining, and the third derivative of the symmetric trace-free tensor. Okay? Okay, this is one of the two contribution at next to leading order. I mean, it's one of the contribution beyond the standard Newtonian Newtonian order, where in a sense you are not, you are taking into account the fact that the velocity is not so small with respect to the speed of light, no? Because you are doing an expansion. First I can cancel it completely, which means using this, so I am in Newtonian theory, V over C is zero, or I take some contribution into account, and when you take this contribution into account, I said you have two pieces. One piece is this, is the mass octuple, because it is the third moment of the mass that you compute in this way, you remove the trace, and you have this. But then there is the other part that actually has not three indexes. I mean, there are three indexes, but these indexes have different meaning. And what you can do, so maybe I can just erase these pieces, and I can write it here. So, for example, at EJ TT octuple is equal 1 over R, sorry, 2G over 3, what was it, 3C to the, yes, 3C to the 5 pi E J K L O 1, 2, 3 K L M. Okay, and then there is the other piece I said. And the other piece, we say, okay, it is this with these moments of the current, because this thing is just a T00 inside, while here there is T0i. And okay, let me rewrite it, ik minus 2 p dot dot k ij. Okay? Now, what to do now? What to do is the following. You can, when you plug here explicitly the expression of the integral of, the expression of this thing, the integral d3x t0 ex jxk, right? There is a derivative somewhere. Anyway, what you find is the following, that doing the calculation explicitly, you have this, 1 over c, you have the 3x, and then you find xl, and then xm t0k minus xk t0m plus xk xm T0L minus XL T0M. That starts looking like angular momentum, and indeed this is what you have here. So you define the angular momentum density JK, that is 1 over c, so define the usual quantity, so xj t0k minus xk t0j, so that this just disappears and become jmk plus xk jml, and all the rest goes away. Okay, then you can eventually, finally, okay, it's there are a few steps in order to go to the final formula. Now you take the, if you use this formula, so the JK. Because here the angular momentum is a tensor. Now you want to move it to have a vector. So you have to define the components of the angular momentum vector like jkl times jl, the usual way also in this case. Okay? And then you finally define, so these are the components of the angular momentum, and you finally define the moments of the angular momentum density. Because in fact, these are all densities of angular momentum, become angular momentum when you do the integral over the 3x. So you have this, ij, which is the integral of d3x of je xj. So what have you done? You have started from something of this kind. You have plugged in the t0j, you have defined the angular momentum, you have defined the vector, the components of the angular momentum, and finally what you have here, these are the moments, let's say, the of the angular momentum density, because this is the angular momentum density, and these are the moments because they are multiplied by xj, the first moment of the angular momentum density. Okay? Once that you have done this and you replug everything there, you find the following. Pa-pa-ra-pa-pa. That hij tt, and this is the current quadrupole now, because there are eventually just two indexes that remain, is the following, is 1 over r 4g 3c to the 5 pi ejkl nm, sorry, two indexes, two time derivatives, p j double dot pl plus epsilon m lp j double dot pk. Okay? Which is that is the other piece that enters at first post-Newtonian order. So yes, maybe you can what is the next step? Yes, this is that's true, yes, you can further symmetrize things, so you can further define a sort of dipole moment of the angular momentum density, I mean the symmetrized dipole moments, because yes, this is this. So is a dipole moment, is the first moment of the thing, then this I think is should be anti-symmetric. You define a symmetrized stuff, which is the following, with this is a strange j, where you have jij plus jje. No, it's not, sorry, it's not anti-symmetric on these indexes, obviously. And eventually, with this quantity, you'll see that this hij is just this is not relevant for the waveform, but it is relevant for the energy flux, so that with this quantity you will find that the energy flux is just 16 over 45 g over c to the 7 triple dot ij triple dot ij. Okay. Conclusion. Yes. Yes, there are. I ignored those things. Yes, 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 yes. There are commas. I am forgetting about that. But the comma is there just to remind you that the various indexes have different origins. Then eventually you forget about that. But yes, so this is correct. So what I just wanted to, yes, indeed. So for the waveform is like this and remains like this. The final formula that you want to look at is the following. When you put everything together, so I can remove all this. Yes. I was too fast. I will rewrite this thing. I mean, you can keep this, evidently. J dot and J dot. Double dot. And okay, just to conclude, we have the energy flux is given by G over C to the 5, and we have our quadruple contribution, that is Q dot dot EJ, Q dot 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 EJ. This is what we saw before. Then you have, there is 1 over C square here, that okay, one has to check all the C factors, because probably some formulas they are there, in some other formulas they have disappeared magically. 16 over 45 J dot dot EJ, this curved J, so is the symmetrized dipole moment of the density of angular momentum, IJ 1, 2, 3. Okay, and then the other 1PN contribution is the octuple with 189 OEJK. Here there are actually 4 times derivative, so in fact the notation O over with an N means that I am taking N time derivatives of the object. So this has a 4 and O EJK 4, okay, plus order V to the 4, C to the 4, okay? So all this thing is the 1PN correction to the quadrupole formula. And maybe we can close this parenthesis. So the conclusion is the following. If I need, for some reason that I don't want to investigate, to compute the gravitational wave emission from something higher than the quadrupole formula using, let's say, standard notation or standard calculation or, let's say, simple things, this is what you have. So this is the Newtonian piece. This is the first post-Newtonian piece. That is something that depends on the mass of the system, the higher order, from the, let's say, the energy density. So this is the higher, the octuple, but this is depends only on the mass, on T00, okay? T00 enters here, while these things depends on T0i, and is in fact related to the angular momentum. In fact, this piece and this piece are parents, while this object belongs to another class of things. Okay, the point is that here we did this in a very, let's say, inductive way, from the very beginning, expanding each piece and then collecting the pieces together. In fact, all this can be done in a very systematic way, including all the possible multipolar orders. And in fact, in linearized theory, there exists an explicit expression, so really at the level where we are working now, so it's just a solution of this equation, so in fact, let's go back to what we did. We took these pieces, we solved this equation, but in fact we are expanding this assuming small velocities. But assuming small velocity is in a sense not needed, because assuming small velocity means doing all this expansion. You can do that, but in fact you can do that including all the possible multiples. So what you can get is an explicit solution in linearized theory that gives you the waveform, the energy, and the angular momentum with all the pieces, without any assumption on the slowness of the on the of the of the source, without any assumption on the motion of the source. And this may be this I will probably discuss tomorrow, because now is late. And briefly sketch for what I can, what are the basis of the multipolar expansion of gravitational radiation using symmetric trace-free tensors. Because you have seen that in all the steps that I did, at the moment I said, the traces are not important, so I remove them. I have tensors that are symmetric, but the traces go away because there is this projector operator that removes them. Actually, you can do this very systematically, because in here, just a symmetric trace-free object exists, and you can expand everything on a basis of symmetric trace-free tensors. That are actually, that is equivalent to expanding things in spherical harmonics, because both give you an irreducible representation of the rotation group in three dimensions. So this is what I will try to do tomorrow, at least part of the lecture, just to give you the flavor of the thing. Okay, I think we can stop here.